Welcome to another episode of the International News Wrap, your go-to source for global updates, presented exclusively by One India. In today's edition, we bring you a wide range of stories from the unfortunate shooting incident in Paris, France, which has left many injured, to the Hamas delegation reaching Cairo for talks on ceasefire. Stay tuned as we explore the most important international developments of the day, keeping you informed about the latest events unfolding around the world. A shooting in a neighborhood north of Paris, likely connected to drug dealing, left one person dead and six others wounded, according to prosecutors and the city's mayor on Saturday, that is 4th May. The attack took place in the parking lot near a cultural center at Sevran, which lies between central Paris and the city's main airport, Charles de Gaulle. Upon arriving at the scene, police found four injured people lying on the ground. One died and the three others were taken to hospitals in serious conditions, according to a police source. Three more people were injured and were taken later to the hospital, added the source and said that two men had arrived in the parking lot in a car and one of them got out and opened fire. The attackers then fled the scene. Sevran Mayor Stephanie Blanchard told AFP, "It was clearly a settling of scores linked to drug trafficking. There is a need to establish order and eliminate trafficking. Those culprits fired live bullets and did not heed appeals for calm," he further said. Police have opened an investigation into intentional homicide by an organized gang. The recent incident comes after stabbing incidents reported in Sydney and another in London. In Sydney, a man attacked a Christian bishop and a priest during a church service. Meanwhile, in London, authorities apprehended a 36-year-old man in northeast London following a series of attacks involving both civilians and police personnel. Initial reports indicated that the man initially crashed his vehicle into a residence on Thurlow Gardens before proceeding to assault multiple individuals on the street with a knife, including two law enforcement officers. A delegation from the Palestinian militant group Hamas arrived in Egypt on Saturday for the latest round of discussions regarding a proposed ceasefire and the release of hostages in Gaza, as reported by the news agency AFP, citing Egyptian media. The talks are scheduled to be held in Cairo. A source within the Egyptian intelligence service indicated significant progress in the negotiations between Hamas and Israel, with Egyptian mediators reportedly reaching consensus on the most contentious issues. In October 2023, Hamas initiated a devastating attack on Israel, resulting in the loss of 1,200 lives, primarily civilians, and the capture of hundreds of Israelis as hostages. In response, Israeli forces launched a vigorous counter-offensive against the Gaza Strip, resulting in casualties surpassing 34,000, injuries to tens of thousands, and the displacement of over a million civilians. A report from the Palestinian Al-Quds newspaper on Saturday suggested that Hamas would soon announce its endorsement of the latest ceasefire and hostage release proposal. According to reports from the Times of Israel, the proposed ceasefire agreement entails a phased approach. The first phase, spanning up to 40 days, would involve the release of up to 33 Israeli hostages held in Gaza, accompanied by an Israeli Defense Forces withdrawal from select areas in Gaza. Subsequent phases would focus on releasing all remaining living hostages, establishing arrangements for sustainable peace in Gaza, and facilitating the exchange of bodies. On Friday, Hamas accused Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu of attempting to undermine the proposed ceasefire and hostage release agreement through threats to continue military operation against the militants. Heavy rains have unleashed havoc upon Brazil's southernmost state of Rio Grande do Sul, resulting in a devastating toll. Local authorities confirmed on Friday that 39 individuals have lost their lives, with fears mounting that the death toll may escalate as dozens remain unaccounted for. According to Rio Grande do Sul's Civil Defense Authority, a staggering 68 people are still missing, while over 24,000 individuals have been displaced by the relentless storms. The impact of the tempest has been widespread, engulfing more than half of the state's 497 cities, which shares borders with Uruguay and Argentina. Governor Eduardo Leite cautioned that these figures are subject to change in the coming days as access to affected regions improves. The scenes in several towns resemble rivers, as inundated streets, destroyed roads and collapsed bridges bear witness to the ferocity of the storm. Landslides and the partial collapse of a dam structure at a hydroelectric power plant further compound the state's woes. Authorities have sounded the alarm over the precarious condition of a second dam in Bento Goncalves, urging nearby residents to evacuate immediately. In Porto Alegre, the state capital, the Guaiba River overflowed, submerging streets and hampering access to the city's historic central districts. Rio Grande do Sul's unique geographical position, straddling tropical and polar atmospheres, has contributed to a weather pattern marked by alternating periods of intense rainfall and prolonged drought. Local scientists attribute the escalation of this pattern to the impacts of climate change. The current catastrophe follows a similar deluge last September, when an extra-tropical cyclone unleashed floods claiming over 50 lives. This disaster came on the heels of a prolonged drought spanning more than 2 years, fueled by the La Niño phenomena and resulting in scant precipitation. President Luis Inácio Lula da Silva personally surveyed the affected areas on Thursday, engaging in discussions with government elite regarding rescue and recovery efforts. Pledging unwavering support from the federal government, President Lula vowed to bolster local initiatives aimed at rescuing and rebuilding communities ravaged by the deluge. In a harrowing case that has shocked Kazakhstan, former minister Kuandik Bishimbaev has been charged with torture and murder with extreme violence following a brutal attack on his wife, Sultanat Nukenova, in November 2023. The incident, captured on camera, depicted Bishimbaev dragging Nukenova by her hair and subjecting her to relentless 8-hour assault at a family-owned restaurant in Almaty. Tragically, Nukenova, aged 31, succumbed to brain trauma hours after the vicious attack. Bishimbaev, aged 43, is currently on trial for the murder of his wife, with CCTV footage of the assault being presented during proceedings at the Supreme Court of Kazakhstan. Notably, this trial marks the first instance of online streaming for court proceedings in Kazakhstan, a detail highlighted by reports from Mirror Online and Reuters. According to the investigation, Bishimbaev and Nukenova had spent nearly an entire day together before she was discovered unconscious at the restaurant. Despite the severity of the situation, the police were not notified and an ambulance only arrived 12 hours after the incident, with Nukenova tragically pronounced dead at the scene. A coroner's report confirmed brain trauma as the cause of Nukenova's death, detailing additional injuries such as a broken nasal bone and multiple bruises on her face, head, arms and hand. In a disturbing turn of events, it was revealed that Bishimbaev sought the guidance of a fortune teller following the attack, who allegedly reassured him that no harm would come to his wife. Despite the evidence against him, Bishimbaev has pleaded not guilty, maintaining that Nukenova's injuries were self-inflicted. In response to this appalling case, Kazakhstan's president Kasym Jomart Tokayev signed a bill named Sultanate's Law on April 15, aimed at strengthening laws pertaining to spousal abuse. Government data further underscores the prevalence of domestic violence in Kazakhstan, with statistics revealing that 1 in 6 Kazakh women has been subjected to violence by a male partner. Russian forces carried out an overnight drone attack on Ukraine's Kharkiv and Dnipro regions, causing injuries to at least 6 individuals and causing damage to critical infrastructure as well as commercial and residential buildings, according to regional officials on Saturday. The Ukrainian Air Force reported that Russian forces deployed 13 Shahed drones targeting these regions in the northeast and center of the country. The air defense unit successfully intercepted and downed all the drones as confirmed by the Air Force commander. However, debris from the downed drones struck civilian targets in Kharkiv, resulting in injuries to 4 people and igniting a fire in an office building, as stated by the regional governor. Oleh Sinehubov, writing on the Telegram messaging app, said, "A 13-year-old child and a woman were being treated in hospital. 2 other women were treated on site. Emergency services were bringing the fire under control," he added. In the industrial Dnipropetrovsk region, 2 people were wounded, said Serhii Lysak, the regional governor. He said a critical infrastructure facility and 3 houses were damaged. Over the weekend, the Russian Defense Ministry reported that its air defense forces had intercepted and shot down 4 US-produced long-range missiles over the Crimea Peninsula. These missiles, identified as Army Tactical Missile Systems, that is ATACMS, were recently supplied to Ukraine by Washington. The ministry provided no further detail regarding the incident.